Much, Mary. And also Monica, I did neglect to mention that back at our piano this morning is Monica Autry, and we are so grateful that she's here filling in again this week. Let us pray. Oh God, indeed, your word is a lamp unto our feet, revealing your will for our lives. By the power of your Holy Spirit, give us each the wisdom to attend to your call every day, and make us ready to hear and obey. As we read this scripture today, may we hear well what you are saying to us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I did think we were going to read all of Ecclesiastes 3 this morning. That was Pastor Becky back in May, looking at the whole scope of Ecclesiastes, thinking I knew how it was going to go. But sometimes you get in the week and you just know that something else is needed. And so this morning, our scripture is the first 15 verses of Ecclesiastes 3, and we'll pick up the rest of the chapter next week. So Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 15, listen now for God's word. For everything, there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I've seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds, yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in all their toil. I know that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor anything taken from it. God has done this so that all should stand in awe before him. That which is already has been, that which is to be already is, and God seeks out what has gone by. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So it's time. It's time to talk about time and how we spend our time and how we understand our time and to turn, turn, turn. That was the most requested song for our Ecclesiastes playlist so far, by the way. We live in a culture that is obsessed with time. Our digital clocks keep the time in seconds and even in milliseconds. We wear or carry devices that tell us what time it is every moment of the day. We set alarms to make sure that we get up on time, that we take our medicine at the right time, that we don't miss anything that we have scheduled. We schedule our appointments with specificity of hour and minute. And then we are told how early we are supposed to arrive for those appointments. By the way, if my appointment is at 2 o'clock, but I'm supposed to get there at 1:45, isn't it kind of like my appointment is at 1:45? I put 1:45 in my calendar just to make sure that I don't lose track and I'm not late. And if you're like me, you keep all of your plans on a calendar, digital or paper. We keep everything in calendars, everything we plan to do, every place we plan to go, every event scheduled for us to attend, every appointment that's ours to keep, except for the ones that aren't on our calendars. The things that happen when the plans fall through or when something interrupts our planning or when everything changes. Because there are interruptions and plans do fall through and circumstances are always changing. And we can write in pencil or in ink or enter it into digital permanence. It does not matter. Things change. When it comes to time, we are given a certain number of years, days, hours, milliseconds even, but we don't know how much. And we can plan how we will use them, but when we look back at our calendars and what we had planned to do and see how it actually came together, we realize that even the plans that we make are hobble. Hobble, remember, is our Hebrew word that the author of Ecclesiastes uses over and over. It means something like vanity or vapor. Or smoke, chasing after the wind. Kohelet, the teacher who wrote Ecclesiastes, had lived long enough to realize this. He didn't have a digital calendar or a watch that he wore on his wrist, but he knew that trying to schedule a life is like trying to grab a handful of smoke. He knew that our lives are lived in between birth and death, mourning and dancing, war and peace. And despite our planning, we don't know how much of any of it we will have. We live within the dash. Now, you may be familiar with the idea of the dash or spending your dash. Scotty McCreery wrote a country song about it. A woman named Linda Ellis wrote a poem that's become popular in recent years. It starts this way. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that first came the date of birth and spoke the following date with tears. But he said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years. For that dash represents all the time that she spent alive on earth, and now only those who loved her know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live and love and how we spend our dash. Kohelet would have appreciated this concept of the dash, I think. He had a good understanding of what it means for life to be lived in between. For everything, there is a season, he wrote, and a time for every purpose under heaven. Kohelet knew that under heaven, life is lived in time. Under heaven, life is lived in time. Let's look at another poem, the poem that begins this chapter of Ecclesiastes. There's intention to this poem's structure. There are 28 actions or items on the list divided into 14 sets. These sets are called merisms. A merism is a figure of speech or a rhetorical device in which two polarities make up a whole. Two actions make up the ends of a spectrum. And these 14 merisms represent so much of life. A time to be born and a time to die, the polarities of birth and death. But so much happens in between, right? Birth and death encircle all of life. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. Planting and harvesting, but there's so much watering and pruning and cultivating that happens in between. Planting and plucking up represent the whole of the agricultural season. A time to weep and a time to laugh. Weeping and laughing represent such a wide range of emotions between sorrow and joy. These merisms in verses 2-8 represent life as it's lived under the sun, or as Kohelet says here in chapter 3 instead, under heaven. And so many of these actions do not come with timing that we can choose. They are often actions that become part of our lives whether we wish them to or not. It's not a matter of choosing to be born or die. These times, everything that's part of living in between, come whether we choose them or not. And so it is with so much that's in this poem. For example, verse 3 is not giving us the agency or the permission to kill or to heal. Kohelet isn't saying sometimes it's just time to commit homicide. I think he's saying that there's a whole spectrum between killing and healing that happens throughout our lives and the lives of our loved ones. We don't get to choose the timing or the actions, but it's a reality under heaven. Perhaps one we may not quite understand what Kohelet is getting at comes in verse 5, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together. This has scholars throughout the ages scratching their heads a little bit, but it seems that maybe Kohelet's talking about agriculture again, such a big part of his society, no doubt. Stones in your field would inhibit planting and harvest, and so you would gather stones together before cultivating a field. Sometimes you'd stack the stones up, or you would use them to create a boundary line around your field. I listen to a Bible podcast every day, The Bible in a Year, with Father Mike Schmitz, by the way. And on Wednesday this week, he read from 2 Kings 3, where ruining an enemy's field by filling it up with rocks was a wartime tactic. And I realized that that may be the occasion for scattering stones, gathering, scattering. But either way, the human experience, it's timeless here in Ecclesiastes 3. We live in a very different time than Kohelet, yet we relate to this poem very well. We know the seasons and the spectrum of living. And aren't we glad that life happens in seasons? We may wish that everything that happens to us would be what we would consider to be good things. But without the things that seem bad to us, how would we recognize the things that seem good? And isn't it wonderful to have the times that invite dancing to balance out the times when we are more mournful, or the times of laughter that come after or even in the midst of sorrow, the times of building up that happen after we've been broken down? And maybe we know that some of the times that we were sure we were on the bad side of the spectrum, the bad side, we realized later that God had used those times for good. We might have a Joseph moment. The back part of Genesis tells Joseph's story. Joseph, son of Jacob, was a man who found himself betrayed by his brothers, who threw him in a pit, which led to him being sold into slavery and then employed by Pharaoh in Egypt and then thrown into prison for something he didn't even do. And then finally elevated to a position of power in Egypt at just the right time. And when he sees his brothers who had set off this chain of events again, he had this to say, Genesis 50:20, "Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good." These realities, these actions, these times in Ecclesiastes 3, we do not often get to choose them or control them, but we can trust that God is at work in them. Because God is the ruler and beautifier of time. God is the ruler and beautifier of time. Kohelet goes back to one of his favorite questions in verse 9. "What gain have workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with." Kohelet's very concerned so far in Ecclesiastes about humanity's gain from all this working and living under the sun. He's looking for meaning within the toil. And here's where he lands this time. Verse 11, "God has made everything suitable for its time." Now, the word suitable in the Hebrew is the word yapha. And suitable is perhaps the weakest translation for yapha in this case. Other English versions do a better job and translate verse 11 this way: "God has made everything beautiful in its time." Beautiful does seem to be a better translation here. If we look at the ways that yapha, the Hebrew word, is used in scripture and its meaning as a word itself, but we might struggle with thinking of all of these things as having the potential for beauty, especially as we look at a list that doesn't only have birth, but also contains death. There isn't only peace, but also there is war. How can death be beautiful? How can war be beautiful? How can hate be beautiful? Well, in itself, some of those things are perhaps not beautiful, but if we believe that God is the ruler and the beautifier of time, if we believe that God is always at work, redeeming, sanctifying, bringing beauty to where there once only were ashes, we might get a sense for why Kohelet chose this word beautiful. Isaiah 61 speaks of a God who is good news for the poor, freeing the captives, binding up the brokenhearted, bestowing a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. Mourning, despair, captivity, brokenheartedness, ashes, they all come into our lives. We find ourselves in seasons where these are realities, but God is always present, redeeming our time, bringing beauty to each place eventually. We also know that scripture says that in the fullness of time, Galatians 4:4, God sent his son into the world in order to redeem those who were under the law so that we might receive adoption as children of God. And Romans 5:6 says that at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. The timeless God, the God of eternity, stepped into time, taking on flesh, born as a baby, executed as a man, resurrected for our salvation, and ascended to reign in glory over time. God makes all things beautiful as he enters history and redeems all things in beauty. And perhaps that is what is meant when Kohelet finishes verse 11 and speaks of God putting a sense of past and future into their minds. Yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. We can sense that God is at work. We can sense that there is something greater, something bigger, someone who can see that long arc of history, the whole plane of salvation, not just our feeble few years. If we can glimpse, even for a moment, the long view of God, the one who holds our past and our future together, who is present at birth and death and mourning and laughter and seeking and in losing, the one who took on flesh and entered our time, we can rest assured that God is the ruler of time, and he will beautify the difficult, terrible parts too in his time. So we have a choice, right? We have a choice. We can fight it or we can receive it. We can fight it or we can receive it. Kohelet returns to one of his favorite refrains in verse 12 and 13. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live, he writes. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in their toil. Eat, drink, and be merry. Kohelet says it again. We heard him say it last week as he considered all the striving and legacy seeking and inheritance leaving that we do as humans. It's all hobble, all forgotten, all left for the benefit of another, he said. You can't control that. Might as well eat, drink, and be merry and enjoy what God gives you. And here too, he says we should enjoy the gifts that God gives in the season that God gives them. We are living in the in-between, living in between birth and death, weeping and laughter, gathering and scattering, and the other 11 merisms from verses 2 through 8. We do not get to choose where we are on the timeline or which season it will be. It's best to learn to discern where you are and live well in the midst. About this, Ellen Davis writes, there's a crucial element of choice involved in living well. We must decide whether our posture will be one of acceptance or resistance, whether we will fight to the death the ever-changing rhythms of life, or whether we will dance to them. We can fight for control and decide that the next song on our Ecclesiastes playlist that we started last week is going to be, "We're Not Gonna Take It." Or we can receive each day, each season as a gift and make up our minds to find the joy and the merriment in it. It is, after all, about living in the dash of time that we have, finding God's gifts wherever we are, knowing that eternity beats inside of us, that sense of past and future where God is always dwelling, trusting that God is making all things beautiful in their time. It's not always easy, and sometimes it takes time itself to see what God has been doing. When we are mourning, it can be hard to see God's beauty in those moments, but maybe we can remember that God is there and that God is working all things together for good eventually. For as Kohelet says, verse 14, I know that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor anything taken from it. God has done this so that all should stand in awe before him. That which has already been, that which is to be, already is, and God seeks out what has gone by. And so to the potentate of time, to the beautifier of time, let us pray. We stand in awe of you, O God. We seek your meaning, your purpose, your beauty in our lives. Teach us to dance to your rhythms and meet you in each season. Give us moments where we can step back and see what you are doing in our lives and the lives of the people that we love. Continue to call us to peace with you as we live out the days you give us. We pray in the name of Christ, the one who came in the fullness of time, the one who continues to rule and reign in our lives. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Becky. That was a brilliant sermon. Please join me in this chorus of Turn, Turn, Turn.
To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time to every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap. Time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time to weep. To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time to every purpose under heaven.
Thank you, Nancy. I invite you now, if you're comfortable to do so, to stand as we affirm our faith together using the first question of the Heidelberg Catechism. Family of God, what is your only comfort in life and in death? Our only comfort in life and death is that we belong, body and soul, in life and in death, not to ourselves, but to our faithful Savior, Jesus Christ, who at the cost of his own blood has fully paid for all our sins and has completely freed us from the dominion of the devil, that he protects us so well that without the will of our Father in heaven, not a hair can fall from our heads. Indeed, that everything must fit his purpose for our salvation. Therefore, by his Holy Spirit, he also assures us of eternal life and makes us wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him.